For our second hot copy, we're now joined by Philippine Senator Sherwin Gatchalian. Senator Gatchalian, thank you for being here today. Thank you, sir.
Good morning, Karen. Good morning to our televiewers.
All right. That was a heated discussion. We aired that earlier between Senator Risa Ontiveros, yourself, and Attorney Harry Roque. Based on that initial hearing, what has come out? Because Chairman Altenco said that when he met Attorney Harry Roque, Attorney Roque did not present himself to be the legal counsel of Lucky South, but he came to the office to assist the lady that you had mentioned in the hearing.
Cassandra Ong. Well, Cassandra Ong plays two different roles at the same time. One as the owner and representative of Whirlwind Corporation, which is the lessee of the land and which where all the Pogo Hubs in Porac was located, all the buildings in the Pogo Hub in Porac was located. And then she is also the official representative of Lucky South 99, which is the applicant for Pogo. So in this, so she plays two roles. My understanding when Chairman Altenco narrated that story was Cassandra was there in PAGCOR playing the Lucky South 99 role because she was following up the license of Lucky South 99. And that's why they discussed about the arrears and the amounts of money that they have to pay. And that is my understanding regarding that story.
Mm-mm. So do you believe at the end of the day, Attorney Harry Roque, in his either professional or personal capacity, was assisting, helping Lucky South 99?
Well, in fairness to Attorney Harry Roque, lawyers have clients and that's normal. They have they have clients, they are engaged by companies, by individuals to perform certain tasks, whether legal or other tasks. That's part of their services. Mm-hmm. And I think Attorney Harry Roque was there to because Cassandra Ong engaged him. And Cassandra Ong probably seek his help in terms of people Attorney Harry Roque knows. Mm-hmm. And that's perfectly normal for law firms. I think law firms, the services of law firms, is basically to provide legal and also other services as much as they can.
Okay, so moving on, speaking of law firms, where is Alice Go?
Well, that is the...
What did the law firm say?
Well, the law firm of Alice Go is not saying anything. They kept quiet for a very long time. And we have various information about her whereabouts, about her location. I can't divulge it right now because everyone is looking for her. But what we moved in the Senate is to already file a formal complaint against her using Article 150 of the Revised Penal Code. And this is for disobedience to summons by Congress. Mm-hmm. So in other words, we will be taking this to court because she blatantly disobeyed the summons from Congress and thereby ignoring the arrest order that Congress or the Senate issued. And this will be a formal complaint already. So she will be compelled to attend the court proceedings and hopefully show up personally.
Would you say that, frankly speaking, she just chose not to show up after she's been exposed and found out? After that expose that you and Senator Risa Ontiveros essentially had on the NBI's fingerprint that she and the Chinese person were one and the same.
Well, definitely she's I think part of her strategy is not to appear anymore in public, and this is to relinquish herself of being compelled to answer questions and to really answer the evidence that is being shown in the Senate. But she cannot do that for a very long time. Eventually, the long hand of the law will catch up with her. And
what if she's in China already?
Well, as I understand, China has a very strict law on gambling. In fact, when we were conducting this hearing, we read in the Chinese law that anyone who participates in gambling and who even just mere employment in gambling can be prosecuted and put in jail. So even though her parents are there, one of her siblings is already in China. If she goes there, there's also a possibility that she will be apprehended because she participated in gambling here in the Philippines, targeting Chinese citizen. Okay. But then again, everything is a possibility right now, Karen, because we don't know where she is, no? Basically. And everything is a possibility right now.
Okay. Now, I think you partly heard Chairman Altenco's interview on winding down POGOs, right? Essentially the IGLs that are left. How would you want to see this happen? What is the process that you would want to see, given that there's 6 months to fulfill the president's order?
Actually, Karen, when we recommended to ban POGOs last March 2023, we looked at the activities in closing down POGOs. We look at what are the major activities that POGOs need to undertake, what are the major activities that government need to undertake in order to completely ban POGOs in our country. And the first order of business should be the 20,000 Filipinos who are working directly in POGOs. Mm-hmm. A lot of them are IT oriented, POGOs being an IT company largely, a lot of them have IT skills. So I'm very confident that they can be transferred to, for example, BPOs and to other IT-oriented companies. But of course, there are rank and file and utility level personnel that we need to find jobs for them. Mm-hmm. And that's why we are recommending to DOLE to come up with a skills analysis. Which people we can transfer immediately to BPOs. Which personnel that we need to give temporary employment or temporary assistance in order for them to find jobs. So that's the first order.
I want to ask you, do you support Chairman Altenco's recommendation? Because he mentioned that there are 12 SBPOs that actually are right now customer service agents for gaming companies, international gaming companies. So there's no gaming in these 12 companies, but they're all Filipino employees. There are 6 more applications for these SBPOs. He said he's not lobbying for it, but he believes because there are many thousands of Filipinos working there, he wants to make the appeal to the president to spare them. What are your thoughts on that?
I have to study that very carefully, Karen, because there's a fine line between these service providers for gaming companies and also actual gaming companies. Mm-hmm. What my understanding is, and this is quite technical, that's why we need to understand. My understanding on this type of business is they only provide services. For example, with streaming, Filipinos are the one doing, let's say, the baccarat or the poker or the Russian roulette, but the actual betting is happening outside of the Philippines, or another company is actually getting the betting. But then again, there's a fine line to that, because you can actually merge these two entities and become one gaming company. But how easy is that to happen? That's something that we need to analyze, because we don't want a scenario wherein we allow that, but eventually they'll again morph into a gaming company and again solicit gaming or solicit bets from China and from other jurisdictions. So we need to be very careful in looking at the technicalities.
Okay. Do you believe there should be another agency that actually monitors? Because PAGCOR, for example, they collect arrears, of course. You need to pay taxes to PAGCOR. But at the end of the day, Altenco said, we don't have police powers when they already canceled the licenses. I mean, it took a while, right? You saw some of them still operating. So let's say, for example, hypothetically, if the SBPOs were to stay, should there be another agency that's actually looking over how these companies are run?
Karen, you're absolutely correct. That's the root cause of all evil with gaming, because PAGCOR is operating as a regulator and as an operator. And there's an inherent conflict of interest with that model. That's why it's very difficult to regulate, because the goal of regulation is to make sure that they follow the rules. Yeah. The goal of operation is to make money. And these are inherently conflict of interest. Okay. And for me, that's the root cause on why we saw all of these POGOs going into illegal scamming activities and illegal activities. Because on one hand, PAGCOR is trying to regulate them, but on the one hand, they're making money out of these entities that they are regulating. So moving forward, one of the legislative recommendations out of this hearing is to separate the regulatory function and the operating function of PAGCOR. PAGCOR should only remain to be a regulator. And that's the model everyone in the whole world is practicing. That's why moving forward, we have to separate the regulatory function.
Uh-oh. So if PAGCOR, based on that idea, becomes just a regulator, will another agency then be formed for operations?
Well, that's an operator. That's a policy question that the government needs to study very carefully. But in my opinion, government should stay out of operation and stay out of business. The private sector can do better in terms of running businesses. I'll give you a case in a hard example. Solaire, City of Dreams, it's all run by private entities, and they're doing absolutely an amazing job in managing their company. They're driven by giving the best service, and they're hard investments in terms of putting up hotels and other facilities. We should leave that operation and that business side to the private sector, because that's what they do. That's what they do best.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. So that's one. Another issue is, let's talk about the workers, right? Right now, there's no exact estimate on just how many foreign workers are in the Philippines because of POGO. This is from the time of former President Duterte. Even after they've whittled down the legal, right, gaming licenses, a lot of them left, but a lot still stayed, no?
Yes.
So as a country, how do you then deport them? When in China, there's a serious punishment for gambling.
Correct. Karen, that's why when the president said that the illegal POGOs are disguising as legal entities, where in fact they're doing illegal activities, mm-hmm. that's precisely what's happening. These legal POGOs, the ones that we are giving license, they're also given an opportunity to bring in workers. But once the workers are here, there's no way for them to monitor where the workers will go. That's why we are, for example, a few days ago, there were two overseeing foreigners.
Fake pa yung passport ng isa.
Correct. Fake pa yung passport.
Chinese siya.
And they're overstayed. I think they were their visa expired in 2020, but 4 years after, they're still here. But the point there is, there are a lot of these cases here in the Philippines. And because of the sheer magnitude of these foreigners coming in, and because of the size of the country, it's very difficult for the Bureau of Immigration to detect where they are. Yeah. A lot of them are hiding somewhere in the provinces. A lot of them are working in other POGOs. So that's why officially there are only 25,000 foreign workers working in POGOs, but there are more. There are more hiding somewhere and working in other entities.
Oh, okay. What happens now? I mean, some have said with the ban, it doesn't mean that IGLs or POGOs will stop, but now they're all underground.
Well, once you ban POGOs, what happened is even the license or the legal POGOs will now will not be entitled to bring in workers. Another loophole here is the workers, because they can bring in unlimited amount of people coming into our country. And these people we have no way of checking who they are. We have no way of checking their background. In fact, those two people who were apprehended in Benguet, one of them is a hardened criminal. He has a warrant of arrest in China, warrant of arrest in other jurisdictions.
A red notice.
Naka-red notice siya. And these are the type of people coming in to our country. And we don't know, we have no way to check who they are. So once we stop that that entry point, then it's easy now to weed out the other POGOs, because the entry point is the one that is allowing all of these criminal syndicates to come in into our country.
Mm-mm. Okay, another question. What do we do with all the structures? What happens then? At the end of the day, when licenses were given to these companies, they infused money, right? So in Bamban, there are buildings there. In Lucky South 99, sabi nga ni Chairman, there were 46 buildings there. In Island Cove, there are 20 structures there. So if the ban will really be enforced, you'll have really, it'll be like a ghost town. But what do we do with all those structures?
Well, Karen, in the case of Banban and Porak, these are illicit money. And yesterday's hearing, even the AMLAC confirmed that the money is coming in to the country and channeled towards building the one in Banban is illicit. So Government needs to confiscate it, because that whole structure and the entire facility is built based on illegal money. Mm-hmm. And
we have to reuse it.
If we don't reuse it, it will deteriorate.
Yeah,
so there are several proposals, like for example, the one in Bamban can be used as a hospital for that area. The one in Porak, I know Senator Angaras looking at making it a school, maybe a training facility for TESDA as well. So there are alternative uses for these facilities. And in fact, these facilities can be turned into a legitimate BPO, because they're actually designed like a BPO company. So they can turn that into a legitimate BPO. But definitely government will confiscate these properties, and the government can put this into productive use.
Oh, okay. I think at the end of the day, the question now is, what are we losing? I mean, you and I have talked about the social ills that come with POGO, right? But we've also talked about, for example, the revenues of gambling itself. No? So for example, CESA, Chairman Altenco said he doesn't know if that's included in the ban, because CESA's able to issue their own licenses. The Solicitor General said that's included in the ban, but CESA has its own charter. What are your thoughts?
Well, Karen, if you read the SONA statement of the president, it's sweeping. She said all POGOs are banned. No? He didn't make any distinction between illegal POGOs or legal POGOs, or POGOs inside CESA, POGOs outside CESA. All POGOs are banned. So with that policy statement, all types of POGOs, or you know, POGO companies operating the Philippines, regardless where they are, cannot operate anymore. So that's very clear with the instructions of the president.
All right. Anything you want to add, Senator, before we go?
Well, Karen, that's important to address the 20,000 Filipinos who are working directly in POGOs. We'll be focusing on that. We will be making sure that they have assistance. There are in the 2024 budget, 18 billion was allocated for temporary employment, and we will make sure that they have access to that temporary employment assistance.
All right. On that note, as always, Senator Sherwin Gatchalian, thank you for joining me today, sir. We do hope to speak with you again. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Karen.